Hello friends, now we will learn pharmacology of antidiuretics. Myself Dr. Tejas Khakkar from Gujarat Adani Institute of Medical Sciences, Bhuj. So let's begin the learning. Antidiuretics are the drugs which reduce urine volume by inhibiting water excretion. So more precisely, these drugs should be known as antiaqueretics, because diuretics are the drugs which increase water as well as sodium excretion, while these antidiuretic drugs have effect only on water excretion without affecting that of sodium level. And the drugs with antidiuretic effect, mainly in case of diabetes insipidus, include antidiuretic hormone or ADH itself, which is also known as vasopressin and is released from posterior pituitary gland along with oxytocin. ADH analogs are desmopressin, lipressin and terlipressin. Another group of drugs include thiazide diuretics and amiloride. Now this group of drugs act primarily as diuretics, but in case of diabetes insipidus, they act as antidiuretics, which is their paradoxical effect. And we will see its mechanism later. Miscellaneous drugs are indomethacin, chlorpropamide, and carbamazepine. Now, these drugs are not primarily used as antidiuretics, but antidiuresis is a side effect of these drugs. So, what is ADH? Chemically, it is 8-arginine vasopressin, which is synthesized in hypothalamus and secreted by posterior pituitary along with oxytocin. Secretion of ADH is regulated by three types of receptors, namely osmoreceptors, volume receptors and baroreceptors. These osmoreceptors will detect plasma osmotic pressure and are situated mainly in hypothalamus and also in hepatic portal system, while volume receptors will detect extracellular fluid level and are situated in left atrium, ventricles as well as in pulmonary veins. Baroreceptors will detect change in blood pressure and are present in aortic arch and carotid sinus. The physiological stimuli for release of ADH include, first, whenever there is increased plasma osmolarity, for example in case of dehydration. Second, whenever there is reduced extracellular fluid volume. And third, reduced blood pressure. So, as we have seen, osmoreceptors detect increased plasma osmotic pressure, hence hypothalamus will send signals to posterior pituitary to release ADH, and this ADH will act upon kidneys to increase water reabsorption. Coming to ADH receptors, there are two types of receptors for vasopressin, V1 and V2. And these V1 receptors are again subdivided in V1A and V1B type. If we see the location of all three receptors, V1A receptors are located on vascular and other smooth muscle, platelets and hepatocytes. V1B receptors are located on anterior pituitary gland, while V2 receptors are present on collecting duct cells of kidney as well as vascular endothelium. The main function of V1A receptor is vasoconstriction, and because of which it is known as vasopressin. The other functions of V1A are visceral smooth muscle contraction to increase platelet aggregation and glycogenolysis in liver. V1B receptors are involved in adrenocorticotropic hormone release from anterior pituitary, while V2 receptors causes antidiuresis, and because of which it is known as antidiuretic hormone. Now V2 receptors also causes vasodilatation in addition, and if you have noted, it is opposite to that of vasoconstriction caused by V1A receptors. But V2 receptors are more sensitive, hence V1A action requires much larger concentration of ADH. In mechanism, all three are G protein coupled receptors. V1A and V1B are GQ type and follow IP3 pathway, while V2 receptor is GS type and increases cyclic AMP by activation of adenylate cyclase in collecting duct cells of kidney. The reason behind why V1 causes opposite effect to V2 is V1 receptors also activates phospholipase A2, which causes release of arachidonic acid and increase in synthesis of prostaglandins, which tends to reduce cyclic AMP level and thus blunts V2 mediated antidiuresis. Coming to pharmacological actions of ADH, first on kidneys, we already know that it reduces water excretion or increases water reabsorption. But how? So first, by translocation of water channel containing vesicles from cytoplasm to apical membrane of principal cells of collecting ducts, and hence exocytosis of so-called aquaporin 2 water channels as shown here. Second, by inhibition of endocytosis of aquaporin 2 water channels. Third, by activation of vasopressin regulated urea transporter in apical membrane. Hence, urea excretion is increased and more space is available for water inside the cell. Fourth and fifth, by translocation and activation of sodium potassium 2 chloride ion cotransporter in thick ascending limb of loop of Hanel. And sixth, by V1A mediated vasoconstriction of vasorector. This action of V1A reduces washing of effect, but this is nullified by V1A mediated reduction in cyclic AMP level. And as you know, V1 effect is seen only at high concentration of ADH. In long term, ADH also increases gene mediated expression of aquaporin channels and sodium potassium 2 chloride ion cotransporter. This is animation of ADH mediated increase in water reabsorption in principal cells of collecting duct of kidney. On blood vessels, vasopressin causes V1 mediated vasoconstriction, which tend to raise blood pressure, and even on high concentration of ADH, V2 mediated vasodilatation may be seen. either in presence of V1 antagonist or selective V2 agonist. These are the miscellaneous effects of ADH on GIT, uterus, CNS, liver, and blood. For example, ADH contracts uterus in high concentration through oxytocin receptors, and vice versa. Oxytocin may also give ADH-like effect in high concentration. In important pharmacokinetic features, ADH itself is inactive by oral route as it is destroyed by trypsin. But it can be administered by intravenous, intramuscular, subcutaneous, or intranasal route. The plasma half-life of ADH is only 25 minutes. Further on this topic, we will continue in next class. Till then, stay blessed.